to who it may concern. I'ma make y'all love me, I'ma make y'all remember my name. All over the world, future looking lovely. Focused on my grind and taking over the game. To who it may concern. I feel like I'm on top of the world. Ain't gon' stop till yo, the games yo. Are unlocked. My name's on yo, top.
I keep it fresher than a peppermint. Brand new segment. Flow got me swole, but homie, I ain't pregnant. Argument irrelevant if we talking fresher than. Cause if you did the math correctly, you would see I'm greater than. Negative your wordplay, plus my delivery. Now you quickly see why my whole grind is looking positive. I be on that hot shit. Grab a mic and rock this. People could not see me, but now they say I'm the obvious. Rhymes, rhinoceros, you fly like an ostrich. Get it, you can't see me, not another man is stopping this. By the way, I'm spitting, you could tell the kid is eating. Yes, it's written, if you doubting, then you bound to be believing. So, take a breath, I'm in your city. Just by the way that I'm buzzing, you could tell that I've been busy. Grinding harder than a Chevy, owning shit like I was Diddy. Did he really go there? Yes, I did, they got to feel me.
I'm recording. Anything you say can and will be used against you in the court of online law.
Yeah. All the bullies that we have around here.
Yeah. Got water. Good. Comfortable?
As comfortable. Got one of my favorite kids here. How can I not be comfortable?
Well, that... I mean, I might not
out
be
of all my it. Years. You're definitely up there.
Yeah. I feel it. I guess we'll just roll right into it, guys. Welcome to this Juan time. Today, my guest is a very great and personal friend of mine. One of my high school teachers and one of the many people I look up to. Many and few. I would say, like, I think there's a lot, but you're at the top of the list, sir.
Oh, wow.
I am joined with by Jeff Peters. You are a teacher at one of the local high schools in Yuma County.
Antelope Union.
The Antelope Rams.
The Antelope Rams. Dang, how many times through the years? Are you an antelope or are you a ram?
Yeah, make up your mind. Wow. I guess I don't know if you know how that came about.
Well, okay, here's the story. Here's the scoop. Antelope is the mountain.
Yes.
That's right next to our school with the big A on it. That's Antelope.
Yeah.
The Rams, that's our mascot. So you'll notice ever since I came here, it's very rare to find a shirt that has antelope and Rams written together.
Really?
If I have the word Rams on a shirt, then I have AUHS. If I have antelope on it, then it's a picture of a ram. Still confuses the shit out of people, but it helps.
I never noticed that.
Yeah, because I got too many. Are you antelope ram? What the heck's going on? So
I guess who came up with the ram as a mascot? Why wouldn't they? Like?
I have no idea. Yeah. That was way before me.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Of course. Petition. We need to sign a petition now to change it. No, I know. Can't.
I was going to tell you, years ago, they petitioned to change the letter jackets back when letter jackets were in it. Oh, my God. It was a firestorm.
Oh,
you don't
imagine.
Mess with. Yeah,
no, tradition. Mess,
yep. Yeah, we had a football coach a few years ago. You know, he brought out black jerseys. And oh, my God. And I mean, it does look tough and black is cool. But, man. The kids loved it.
Yeah.
But the public went crazy.
The traditionals.
Yep.
Traditionalists.
Yep, exactly. Yeah. You don't mess with, you know, there's certain things you don't mess with. So.
Yeah. Well, Pete, I just wanted to have you on and just, you know, have a conversation like we would have any other time, but maybe kind of, you know, dig a little deeper what you're trying, you know, as much as you're willing to divulge in what goes on up here.
Not much. Not much.
God damn it. You never fail to make me laugh. I always have a good time with you when you're around. And it's just awesome. That's why anytime I'm in town, you know, I definitely reach out to you. And anytime you go up there, you know, I'm like, hey, where are you?
love going to comedy clubs with you.
Yeah, you kind of got me into
comedy.
I always like comedy, but recently I've gotten into, you know, my hand in stand-up, and you had a lot to do with that.
Well, You know, ever since from the beginning, you know, I've always said you look like Will Smith. You know? You're always my Will Smith guy here on campus.
I got the ears. They're under these headphones.
And the smile. So, yeah, it's fun to be here because it's nice when students become friends.
Yeah.
You know, and that's you know, a natural. When you work around people for as much as you and I worked around, besides the classroom, Stuco and all that stuff.
Yeah.
You know, you just naturally form relationships and friendships. And so that's part of the big reward for me. You know, I have several students from the past who are now best friends. Mm-hmm. You know, they're almost like sons and daughters, you know, so it's cool.
Yeah, that bond definitely forms. I had that conversation with one of the other guys because he teaches young kids, you mm-hmm. know, how to, you know, work, improve their mobility, explosiveness, and training. And I'm like, that bond that you form with, you know, the male, you know, figures in your life, like, you know, when you spend as much time as you do, as we did, you know, mm-hmm. going on multiple trips, like we were just talking about before we started recording, like, my junior year into my senior year that summer, like we must have traveled.
We did.
I think I saw you more often than I saw my parents that summer. Like we were up in Sholo, we were up in Prescott, we were in San Diego, like all over the place.
Chicago.
Yeah, Chicago. It was that summer. That's right. Chicago, St. Louis. Like,
Did the Segways?
Yeah, that's right. I was dressed like a UPS driver. Who allowed me?
I don't know. That's always a hoot when you look at yearbooks. Like, I really wore my hair that way.
Oh sure,
definitely. Especially the girls back then with the big hair and stuff. It was fun.
Yeah, the girls definitely. Kind of, you're able to tell like the year depending on the girl's hair, right?
Yep.
And yeah, I like this as the backdrop too, because the showcase is like just the years and years. Like, when did you move down?
Well, okay, I moved to Wellton in 1980.
So let's go back to the start. How much did you weigh when you were born?
I've actually lost. No.
So you're from Minnesota? Or?
Yeah, I was right on the border. The hospital I went to was in Iowa. So technically I was born in Iowa, but it was 7 miles back to home in Minnesota.
Gotcha.
So I'm from Minnesota, yeah.
Okay.
And then I moved to Iowa for some high school, and then I went to Missouri to college, and then my first job was in Nebraska for 6 years. And then in 1980, Jane was like tired of the little school that we were at.
Mm-hmm.
And so she said, I want to move. And I said, and I loved it. I loved where I was.
Yeah.
And so I said, I'll move, but I'm not going to go, you know, 40 miles. Let's move. So
get it.
So somehow we found out about this job in Wellton, Arizona. And we literally did take out a map and we said, okay, well, we can go there for a couple of years and then we'll move to Phoenix, you know, or San Diego. And then of course fell in love with Wellton, which is, you know, all my friends in Phoenix are like, what the hell? But you know, for 11 years, we had the perfect life. We had a house in Phoenix. And so as soon as school was out in May, we would move to Phoenix and go to ASU and do grad work.
Mm-hmm.
And then we just lived up there and did the city life. And then when August came, we went back to the small town because that's where we like to teach.
Country living.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Love small towns. Yeah.
Yeah, so the dynamic is definitely different.
Yep. And then taught 6 years at Wellton and then moved to the high school. So
What did you teach at Wellton?
Social studies, Arizona history, and American, you know, government and stuff like that.
Oh, all the boring stuff.
Yes. Oh, my God. It was
not no more. It's all the interest. It's all everybody wants to talk about now.
When we first moved here, it was so exciting, though, because we had never been around the Mexican culture.
That's right.
You know, we spent a lot of time going to San Luis, San Felipe, Mexicali, San Diego, and all the teachers in Wellton, all the junior high were all young. And so we all just got together and went to LA and just, we had so much fun those 6 years, just, you know, exploring, no kids, you know, we just explored.
Yeah. Yeah.
Loved it.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. And it was my first time teaching bilingual and the problems of migrant workers. You know, they would be in my classroom for a month or month and a half, and then all of a sudden, hey, where's Juan? He's gone to Juan to do apples, you know, in Washington. And then he'd move back a few months later and like, have you been in a classroom? You know, and it was just so tough.
Wow.
And then the language and
the little barrier.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep. Wow. So even to this day though, you know, I'm teaching now at Antelope. I have a freshman class and I have two boys who speak no English. And that particular period they're stuck in, there's nobody available on campus to help me. So the poor boy that sits between them, besides doing his own work, he's got to let Armando and Miguel know what the hell's going on in class.
Wow.
And it's, yeah, I feel sorry for him.
So you, you give him extra credits?
Yeah. Can you draw that soccer ball? I'll give you credit. But yeah, it's I feel sorry for him, you know, that we don't have better help for him.
Yeah.
Especially for English. I mean, a core class.
Yeah.
You know, it's just crazy.
And so at this point, would that be a lack of funding, or we don't have a person available?
Probably both, I suppose. But mainly to me, it's a scheduling problem.
Okay.
You know, but because there are a couple of people on campus who help people, ESL people,
uh-huh.
but they're not available that period.
Oh, gotcha.
So they
gotcha.
Can take my English and go later on and get some help, but mm-hmm. it's not the same.
Yeah.
It's not the same. Because I have a lady who's available fourth period, and she's here, but I don't really, I mean, she helps me, but it's not, I need the help sixth period, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know how I got off on that tangent, but it, you know, it's one of the things that gets you going as a teacher, you know, just helping the kids.
Yeah.
Because that.
Well, and you could tell that you do it for the right reasons, because you drive one way, how many miles?
It's probably about, what, 25 miles?
Maybe? 25 miles. Yeah. And you've been doing it for how long?
A long time. This is 40-some years. Well, driving there, yeah. But, well, we moved there before Jenny was born. So, yeah, probably 26, 28 years.
So, 5 days out of the week, not counting your breaks, you make that 20, 25-mile drive every morning.
Right. But you know what? It's you get on the freeway. The only bad thing is going through the border station, but they know me. They wave me through. But I mean, if you live, you know, where you live.
Well,
you
not
know,
only that, but you got blue eyes and white hair.
That's true.
This guy, get out of here. You're slowing us down.
I always have a 20 sticking out of my pocket right here. But yeah, I know. You know, white guy does help over there. It's sad, but true.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's where we are, right? Yeah. It's where you said. We're not a border town because we're not on the border, right. But it's just
I've always been against it. I've always said if I was ever elected president, the first thing I'd do is shut down the border. I mean, you know, put them on the border.
Yeah.
I have no problems with that. But why should Wellton be singled out compared to Somerton and other, you know, I mean.
The random inspection stations is what you're referring to.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm against it. But anyway, the other point I was going to make is there's people in Phoenix who drive from Mesa to work downtown, and they probably go farther than I do.
That's true.
And I have no, other than the border station, I don't have any.
There's no red lines.
There's no traffic.
No that big traffic. Yeah. Oh, for sure. Not. You know, you got it right. Because people live in Maricopa and drive out to Chandler to work as well.
Yeah. See, and
but
I love.
To do it, I'm saying, for like almost 30 years.
Yeah, it does. And then a lot of times my morning starts with me actually going into Sam's Club, picking up supplies and coming. You know, I'm always doing that. So.
Yeah. And all I'm trying to get at is that you can tell that you do it. I just noticed the AUHS and then Rams. Yeah, that's right.
I tell you.
Picking it up.
I got tired of people telling me. What are you guys?
Oh, no. Antelope Union Rams. Class of 2001 and 2002. They messed up.
Where's that at?
You put your ass on it.
Oh, yeah.
So I guess that there's no, if you're sitting on it, it's whatever.
I think I bought that. Somebody else did that. They made a mistake there.
But yeah, to get up and do that, like, and to come out here to, again, it's a small town. Like, people wouldn't normally see, not the benefits, but the what's the word I'm looking at for? Like,
about being in a small town?
Well, to do that, most people would be like, okay, I'm in a big city. I know I'm going to have to drive this and that. Whereas when you're out here, and I grew up around it, so it's not an issue.
It's
like,
kinda common.
You know, living in Wellton, right down the street from here, and then the hospital is freaking 45 minutes away. Like, we'd go grocery shopping.
People
have
to take ice chests to go shopping. Yeah,
so exactly.
The milk gets home cold.
Exactly. Like, I'm used to that for sure. But like, then, you know, I've been living up there for 13 years.
Well, when I first moved here, we had two TV stations. You know, we lived in Wellton.
Yeah.
We had two TV stations, and then you could get all central if you put this special thing from Radio Shack on your antenna. And then calling from Wellton to Yuma was a long distance back then. Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah. And I remember my neighbors, when we moved in, they must have thought we were weird because I'm scared of heights. So I had Jane on the roof positioning the antenna. I'd run inside. Nope, still kind of cloudy. Okay, moving it more. And then
Jane coming out.
And I had to get El Centro because I don't know if you remember this, but there was a show back then that I could only get through El Centro called Married with Children.
Oh,
and
yes.
I'm embarrassed to say it probably, but I had a Married with Children club. And it was my job to tape it on Sunday. And then everybody would bring their food into my room and we'd all watch Married with Children because it was so funny. God, Javier Barraza. I remember Javier Barraza. If I didn't get it taped, he was so pissed.
Yeah. Oh, you better be on top of that.
That was such a funny show back then.
It's great.
It was classic.
Thinking about bringing it back just like everything else. I've heard about it. I don't know. But yeah, it was. And I remember, I mean, I was freaking like, you know, eight or nine when it was out. So it was like.
But we could only get it through El Centro on Sunday night. So I had to tape it and bring it to school and share it with the kids. Well,
so you've already dropped a bunch of things for these kids.
It was like modern day crack, you know? Yeah,
it was.
It was pretty edgy for back then.
It's super. Well, it's edgy now.
It probably is.
Because of the climate right now.
Oh, that's true.
The highlights of him on how he talks to women.
Yes,
it's like,
yes.
Whoa, but it's a show. This is a character, you know?
Yep.
Yeah. But you have to educate some of your kids. You've already dropped Radio Shack. You got to describe to them what Radio Shack is.
Long distance.
And you said you have to record it and be there on time or else you miss it. Like, they don't know that.
I know.
You stream it whenever.
I know. It's crazy. It's crazy. Yeah. So yeah, I thought we would end up, I bought a lot in Wellton up on the golf course, the old golf course. And I thought we'd build a house there because I don't know if you know this, but when I got ready to move from Wellton, I was vice mayor.
Uh-uh.
And I probably would end up, you know, I don't want to brag, but I probably would have had to take my turn as mayor, you know?
Hey.
But Jane, when we get ready to build the house, there kids always were stopping over, uh-huh. You know, just always stopping over. So she said, could we put a mountain between us so maybe they wouldn't stop over quite as much? I said, sure. So then we bought the lot at Mesa del Sol and it ended up being, you know, a good move. And like I said, we ended up having kids and all that.
Yeah.
But I really still love Wellton. I mean, I probably would live there still if I could.
Well, I think we're talking about death during breakfast.
Yeah,
you mentioned that.
Yeah, we're matter of fact, where else would we be buried? You know, I mean, we've, you know, 40 years of our life, you know.
Yeah, I mean,
it's crazy when you think about
Jane
it.
Jane was my kindergarten teacher, and then you were my high school teacher.
Yep.
Like, it's
both ends.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
when
ingrained. You think about it, and a blink of an eye, too, you know, just crazy. Because we did not think we'd stay here that long.
Yeah, you were talking about, well, we'll move down there for, a handful of years and then leapfrog.
But the kids are so, I mean, the parents are great, but the parents are, you know, this is going to sound weird, but I have a kid in my class. I taught his grandpa, his dad, and now him. Now, does that make you freaking old or what? I mean, that's a rare.
And they're having kids young.
I know. I mean, it's a rarity, but that, yeah.
Grandpa?
Yep.
Wow.
I know. They asked me because way back when I first got my first teaching job in Nebraska, first of all, my first salary, I was offered two jobs, one in Missouri for $6,000 a year, or I could go to Nebraska for $6,850. And that was when you got paid once a month. You had
I
know. So I took the Nebraska job for $850. Why not?
Yeah.
But to get it, I had to coach football.
Oh.
And you know me, I'm probably the least football type person. So luckily I wasn't the head, I was just the assistant.
Okay.
And oh my God.
Assistant, were you giving out plays
to the other team? He eventually taught me how to wrap ankles. Because I remember during the game, he'd say, what'd that linebacker do? And I go, okay, now which one's the linebacker? And I'll tell you what he did. It was so bad back then. But I took it I played dumb just to get my job, you know.
Yeah.
I can coach football, sure.
Fake it till you make it.
When I moved to Wellton, I ended up coaching basketball.
Okay.
And basketball is my favorite sport by far. I can't play it, but I love it.
Yeah.
But I ended up that year with Richard Powell and Jesse Quiros. And I mean, we just kicked butt. And I didn't have to do anything because they were just so talented.
Mm-hmm.
So this girl's in my class this year. And I said, your grandpa was on my basketball team. And she looks at me like with this stunned face. She goes, how old are you? I go, you don't want to know.
Yeah, you're part of the school.
So
when the school was built, they brought you in.
So, I mean, it's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, and you do.
Speaking of that, I got to tell you about something I started a couple years ago. I'm so proud of it. I do what's called the Golden Grads. And I don't know if you've even known about it. I started maybe 4 or 5 years ago. And I'm so hoping when I leave that they continue it. Because what I do is we invite the grads from 50 years ago to come back. and they wear gold gowns and they lead our seniors in.
Oh.
And they sit on the field with them. We have special seats for them. It is so, it's a thing only a small school can do.
Yeah.
So just think about that. Isn't that cool?
That's super cool.
Yeah. Man. So like somebody from, you know, whatever, 68, 69, you know, they're coming back.
Oh.
It's so fun when, cause they meet in the cafeteria with the seniors that night and get their gold and they take pictures. And then I introduce them to the seniors and the stories are crazy.
Yeah. I can imagine.
It's all the old days, you know. Now half these buildings weren't here and, you know.
Yeah. Has the field always been called Buckeye Field?
No, I don't. Well, I think so. Because, you know, it's named after the farmer that gave us the land.
Oh, okay.
So I think probably.
Oh.
That I don't know, though. But
interesting.
But anyway, it's really cool. I like history, you know. So it's so cool to bring those old people back and... Well, and they're about like my age now.
And you taught them, no.
Yeah. So like Mr. Woodhouse, who we met this morning at breakfast,
yeah.
You know, he was 2 years ago.
Oh, okay.
And you know, and then what they do is they turn it into a like a reunion and they have a big old party that weekend. And
they go harder than the 10-year reunion.
Yeah, they really do, you know. And it's just been so much fun. It's so cool.
Yeah.
That and then the other thing that my other legacy to me is my freshman retreat. You know,
yes.
we started as a lock-in in the gym,
mm-hmm.
and then it just dawned on us, why don't we, you
go.
Know, yeah. I mean, again, only a small school can do it.
Yeah,
you know, this year is one of our biggest classes. We have a little over 60.
Yeah.
So you know, taking all them up to camp in Prescott for a weekend and doing a bonding because you know
it's a lot.
It's just so cool. God. Yeah.
You just do so much.
Yeah. Well, that's why I don't know about that, but I'm just saying I hope someone keeps it going.
Yes. Yeah.
Because, you know, it does take a lot of work. Because
mm-hmm.
the hardest part is the money, you know, fundraising. And,
yes.
God damn. I've always said I love my job except for the fundraising, you know. And this is a small community, so you're going back to the same people constantly.
Yes. Yeah,
you know,
that's right. That's
digging in their pockets, so.
And... You know, it seems like they come through a lot of the times as far as,
you know. You only sell so many little Caesar pizza kits, you know.
Yeah.
When you were in school and we did the skeek, did we still do the evergreen sales?
Yeah.
Did we see?
The wreaths?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't do those anymore, but yeah, I was wondering.
Yeah, we did that. I think we did roll tacos. We did
cookie dough. Oh, yeah, that was a biggie. Yeah.
Krispy Kreme.
Oh, yeah, still do that.
Yeah.
Krispy Kreme's still a big one here.
Yeah. That'll never slow down.
And my kids hate fundraising, but...
It's part of it.
It is. It's just, God dang.
Well, I guess that was an easy move, right? You're a vice mayor and you go into all this and you're fundraising either way, right?
Yep.
Fundraising is the name of the game.
Speaking of vice mayor, see, that goes me back... The only reason I even ran for office was because I was tired of having two channels. So I said, I will bring us cable. So I brought cable to Wellton. I was
one of the,
it wasn't just me, but
yeah.
I kind of moved the board, the council in that direction. And back then, cable was the big old dis, you know, and behind this fenced area.
So what year was this?
Oh my God.
1782?
Yeah. What year was it? It would have been in the 80s anyway. So,
in the 80s.
Yeah.
That's huge.
Yeah. When I first got here, I got involved in Kiwanis and, you know, because I'm big on community service, you know, I'm big on that.
But, yeah.
You know, I just think that's how little towns run. You have to mm-hmm. have, even our volunteer fire department, I wasn't on it, but I mean, I'm just, that's how small towns are, you know.
Yeah. I was having a conversation with Jose Castro where mm-hmm. I'm like, yo, if there's not a statue at
Big
Antelope
Jose, Pete, old Jose?
Yeah, old Jose.
Yeah, he was my first senior class.
Oh, really?
Uh-huh.
Oh, okay. So
great
you're not,
kid.
You're not that old.
No, but what a great kid. God.
Oh,
he
he's the best.
I just loved him. He was such a good kid from then on. Yep, just.
Yeah, he is the best. And I was telling him, I was like, if there's no statue of you erected when you pass away, like somewhere near the park or, you know, just somewhere in Wellton, like,
yep.
I'm going to be very mad.
Oh, yeah. He's just
And he's the same, you know, community. Mm-hmm. Community. It's all about, you know.
Oh, yeah. He would do anything for anybody. And he's gotten really involved here, you know, even though he doesn't have any kids here anymore. He's coaching football. He coaches basketball. Yeah, I mean, he's just, and he always has a smile. I love that.
Always. Man. Yeah.
And he's awesome. A kid to me, but I mean, you know, he's not really a kid, but.
He's a kid.
He is a kid. Yeah.
He's a big kid.
Yeah. He's a big kid.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love that. Yeah. Yeah, that first class. You know, there's certain classes that stick in your head. Like, I have a kid right now who's really into soccer. He plays club soccer in Yuma.
Okay.
And he said the other day, he said, Pete, my coach was one of your students. I go, who is it? And he says, Lalo Quintana. And it's so weird. I can picture Lalo Quintana in my 6-period English class with Laura Barraza and Jason Simpson.
How do you remember all these names? No,
that's what I'm just saying. There's certain classes that I remember that particular 6-period English class.
Oh, gotcha.
Because they were just so, you know how they clicked.
Yeah, you
know
what I mean? And you looked forward to it.
And they were also, they were all so driven and smart and inquisitive and just, God, that was a fun period.
Yeah.
You know? And there were some other ones, that were in there that I remember. And it's just, but Lalo, man, it just shot back memories, Just
right back to it.
Yeah.
Which, it makes sense. Like there's certain classes, because I experienced that, I think it was my sophomore year. Mm-hmm. We were taking one of Mr. Truitt's class. And like 2 weeks in, he kind of was like, something about this class is a little bit different. And he was on his way out. So he was like, I'm going to use every Friday to just teach you life lessons.
Oh, yep.
And we're like, okay. He's like, because I think you guys
will benefit. We'll enjoy it.
This is a good class. I can sense it. Blah, blah, blah. Yep. he was at the end, so he really didn't care how he said it. He's like, some of these other classes suck. And So, but yeah, that was interesting just to get, a perspective from an older, seasoned teacher.
And God dang, you had to appreciate his humor because he had just... he would just be so straight faced and so slammy. Oh my God, he could torture you.
Get him in a roast.
Yep. He taught at the same time as a guy named Norm Champagne, who
I remember the name.
He was the auto teacher, and then he went on and he teaches. He's still at COFA, and he's pretty big in skills and auto and stuff. But God, those two used to friendly fight in what we had the teacher's lounge back then. Oh my God. And of course we could still smoke on campus, and Truitt was a big smoker. Truitt was, he was a hoot.
For sure.
He ran, I should tell your younger audience, he ran a thing called the library. It was filled with books. People actually had to go in.
They're just tablets that you pull out.
They have these things called encyclopedias.
Dictionary. Oh,
can you imagine that was a job at one time, selling encyclopedias door to door?
Door to door. I know my mom had the Britannica.
Yep. That was big. Yeah, no, that was a salesman job. You went door to door selling encyclopedias.
Damn.
I know, isn't that crazy? They would even sell them. And this, I'm sure I'm not making this up. They would even sell them like installments. Like, I'll give you A through C now, and then you pay it in D through F or I.
Jesus.
If you wanted to look up Jesus, like you had to wait a couple months. Well, no, I guess you could look up Christ and see. Well, that was your
first. Do you have any encyclopedias up in here? What do we got? I see a big dictionary over there.
I got a lot of dictionaries, and trust me, they go unused because I let my kids use their phone.
Well, why wouldn't you?
I mean,
to an extent, you know? It's all the information available to you.
Yep, they're all dictionaries. Yeah, I don't ever. I believe in. I guess I'm one of the more lenient teachers on campus for phones.
Yeah.
I let them plug them in here, of course, and then if they're pertinent to what we're, if they want, a lot of them will write their essays on their phones.
Yeah.
And then perfect it and then email it to me. So, I don't know. Even spell check, and people don't have to be quite such good spellers anymore. Why fight it? I don't know.
Well, one thing I try to do is still get all my grammar and punctuation right, even in text messages. Mm-hmm. Like if I'm using like the voice of text, I'll say like comma, period, question mark.
Yeah.
Like I try to do that because there's not enough of it.
Right.
And
yeah. And I do, we do grammar every week, I keep doing grammar, of course, but yeah, it's totally different ballgame on that end.
Oh, for sure.
And then reading is different too, because it's kind of sad to say, but almost all our reading has to take place in class. I don't know how it was, if you had changed or not, but like when I first started teaching, I could give the kids a novel and say, okay, everybody have chapters 1 through 5 for Monday. We'll sit in a circle and talk. Well, that just isn't going to happen.
No.
They're just not going to read it. Mm-hmm. And I mean, you can threaten F's and everything, but they're just not going to read it.
Yeah, I wasn't a reader.
No. And so now, Now you pretty much have to read it in class. You either read it out loud in class or, you know, follow along on YouTube and stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah. And the second thing is I don't even know if I could afford a novel for every kid anymore. You know, now they could just give you a classroom set.
Yeah, right.
How many novels you need? 45. Can you get by with 20? I guess.
I might have to.
Yeah.
I mean, I do have two students that don't even speak.
Yeah.
They'll get by.
Oh, you know, I just had a classic picture in my junior class. It's on my, I just got a new phone, so it's on my old phone.
Yeah.
But these two big junior boys are sitting right over here behind me next to each other. They're sharing the headphones,
uh-huh.
And they're reading their short story.
Hey.
The Short Happy Life of Francis Macomber by Ernest Hemingway.
Ernest Hemingway.
Yep.
I can't say I've read it. I'm familiar.
Oh, it's so good.
Yeah. Well, it's
about
right?
It's about a rich American and his wife, and he goes hunting. And he's scared of the lion. He proves he's a coward. And his wife is just like, can't believe I married a coward. And then at the end of the story, he turns into a hero and she shoots him.
Of course. Why would it end happy?
Right. Yeah. It's a really good story, though.
But yeah, I can see that.
Sounds weird.
It needs to, you need to be challenged. Hemingway, though, I think he's accredited with the shortest story. I think it was like one sentence. Like there was like some competition with like who can make the shortest story,
right?
You know, full story,
right.
And I think it goes for sale, baby shoes never worn,
and that's a story.
That's a story. Huh. For sale, baby shoes never worn.
Hmm.
Somebody selling baby shoes,
right,
for a kid that never made it to wear them. So they,
how sad,
maybe miscarriage, maybe what's the word where SIDS, where kids,
right,
there's no really no crib. No cause. Yep. Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah, I think that was Hemingway. That's deep.
I don't even know. Yeah, that is deep. I don't even know if SIDS was, well, I don't know, because you know he died in 61, shotgun blast.
Mm-mm.
Yeah, he committed suicide.
Ugh.
But I don't know, I've never read
tortured mind, huh?
Yes. Yeah, I don't know, I'll have to look that one up. I like trivia like that.
You do. I remember, I think for...
So do you still read?
I try to right now. I'm pretty busy with this and my full-time job and just trying to write jokes. But reading. I had really, really got big into like the self-help stuff. So I read like three books, like
back-to-back.
Actually,
I remember that. Yeah.
And then I had like 5 years ago bought the Game of Thrones books.
Oh.
And so I had read like the first two and then was like, eh. And then I'm like, well, if I'm starting, because I was like, I need to start reading. I need to start reading. And I'm like, well, I have these books here and I like the story. I love the show. I need to read them. So right. I read the next two books, three and four, like bam, bam. And then I'm stuck on five, like just finding the time for it.
And you know, he's writing because he's writing his own ending, which I think they should have done for them because... I don't know.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I mean, I don't know how you would have ended that show without pissing some people off anyway, but...
Well, I tell people that show was seven and a half seasons because it wasn't even a full, eight. When it should have been, I would say it should have been 12 seasons.
Oh.
At least 10.
Yeah.
And they finished it in seven and a half. Yeah. But it just got so big. It got so big, so expensive.
Yep.
And they got tired.
And popular.
Yeah.
I remember my son telling me that when the dragon lady turns evil. I remember talking with my son about how they should have really developed that more. You know, she was just like, boom, she became evil.
Switch.
Yeah. And that just didn't do that character credit because it was such a main character. No,
they just wanted to get up and
they
get out
because
they were beat down.
Right, right.
That's all. Yep. That's what it was. But it's like, do you tag somebody else in or do you finish out what you set to accomplish, even if it wasn't?
Yep.
My best.
But man, we were tied to that. Jane and I love that.
It's one of the best shows. Yeah.
Yeah.
For sure. That one and Westworld.
I love Breaking Bad.
Breaking Bad is great.
And you know that's a movie coming out next week.
Mm-hmm.
I know.
I heard.
That's crazy.
Yeah. I haven't seen the trailer, but I've heard. So what are you a part of right now?
We can talk forever about movies.
Oh, I know.
I know, we're movie nuts. Yeah. What's up about school? What?
Yeah. What else like do you head? I mean, because you're student council, key club at one point. I don't know what you're doing now, but it was key club, ski club, coaching tennis.
Yeah, we're really fortunate. I had a really good student, Aaron Ferris.
Oh yeah.
Who was you know, he was on my tennis team and in class. He was sophomore president, you know, student council. So he came back and did his student teaching under me. a couple years ago. And so I told him, I said, if you come here and teach, I will gladly give up government and history, because I like working with seniors. But I said, I'll gladly give that up and I'll go back to English. And so he did that. So he's here because we needed, you know, he's young and he's, you know, he's a really good teacher and he can coach. And so to me, it was worked out great. So anyway, I gave him tennis too after 20 some years. So that was really nice too, so that he took that over because he's a great tennis player.
Yeah.
And so now I still have student council and key club. And then I got rid of ski club and I have what's called adventure club.
Okay. Yeah.
And we we do hikes and, you know, Telegraph Pass. This last year I took him over to Palm Springs, did the canyon, and then on over to San Diego. And it's just a bunch of kids who like to hike and,
yeah,
get sometimes them I'm out. Like, sometimes I'm on the lawn chair going, okay, go up that mountain, guys. I don't know if you've done, have you done Telegraph Pass?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah, I've done it.
That is so strenuous.
I've done it twice.
Okay.
In the last like couple years when I come down.
Yep.
And
have you ever done Palm Canyon?
No.
You know, sometime when you come down, I'm serious, let me know and I'll go up to Palm Canyon with it.
Would take the razor?
No, because it's like 60 miles north of Yuma, but it's the only place. Okay, so Palm Canyon's about 60 miles north of Yuma,
okay,
and then another 10 miles off the road.
Okay,
but when you get there, it has a parking lot and stuff. But it's the only place where palm trees are native to Arizona.
Really?
Yeah, and you hike back up in there, and then you see these palm trees in the canyon, and it's beautiful. And sometimes you see, you know, rams and stuff, and it's just
antelopes too.
Yep, bighorn. Yep, antelopes. But you have to really look because it's hard to tell. That's gonna be our theme today.
It is. Yeah, I definitely, you know, love to get active. So
yeah, but yeah. I will take you on the rhino too. Of course, that's always fun.
You got all these plans. We're gonna hit up coffee shops. We're
gonna hurry because I'm getting older.
So I really brought you on this podcast because you were telling me how you're gonna. No, I'm just playing. It's not.
I was gonna tell you about it.
Not this time. Not this year. Maybe next year.
Yeah. Who knows? Who knows? The other big thing that I do, and I'm not sure when. I think I did some of it when you were in school, but I'm the associate director for the state of Arizona for student councils.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So that takes some of my time too.
Well, yeah. You're jetting up there.
Yeah. I go to Phoenix quite a bit and, you know, I handle like, you know, we have the state convention and camp and all that kind of stuff. And I don't know how long, much longer I'll keep it. I just got reelected. It's a 4-year term, but, I really like it because, to be honest with you, it brings some nice benefits to little antelope.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, I can usually state convention, you can only take 12. I can take 14, 16, you know,
gotcha.
That kind of thing. Also camp. I just, you know, I can put them with who I want for SC, you know, I can just place them. And
yeah.
I don't know. There's just, cause antelope's a small school and it's kind of a nice benefit.
Yeah, that's crazy that you're
and I enjoy it.
You're one half of the head, and you're from little Wellton and Antelope.
Yeah,
yeah.
I know people when they find out, they're always like, you know. And like I said earlier, you know, my friends are always like, "How come you're not in Phoenix?" You know, but it's hard to tell people what this is like unless they've been down here. I mean, I can walk over and I could just on my lunch period go talk to my superintendent. Well, you can't do that in Phoenix.
Yeah.
You know, most teachers don't even meet their superintendent during their whole career.
Wow.
Or they're like, "Superintendent's on campus? What's going on? What's wrong?" You know?
Is it anything like the show Vice Principals on HBO?
Did you watch that one? Yeah, I have seen that. Yeah.
So it's wild.
There is some crazy shit that goes down in the teacher's lounge that people probably don't know about, but you know.
Yeah, that'll come after you retire.
Yeah, because that's where you get rid of your stress, you know. And,
yeah.
You know, things you can't say in class, you know.
Just go into the closet and yell.
Exactly. Exactly. Because, oh my God.
Oh man.
Or a lot of times I shouldn't probably say this, but I'll have kids in class and I have my, you know, my senior aides that you're close to, you know, they'll be in my office over there and I might go in and say, "Hey, look what Billy's wearing today." And then I'll come back out and just start teaching and they'll come out and look, "Oh shit." You know?
You gotta make it fun.
Oh, you got to.
And
some people are just,
that's Pete 101. Hey, speaking of Pete, how did you get the nickname Pete? Like who was the first person?
Well,
to,
my dad is Pete.
Okay.
My dad's name.
So wait.
My dad's name.
Okay.
My dad's always been my hero. So my dad is Virgil Vern Peters.
Oh, okay.
And he never, nobody ever called him Virgil. He was just Pete.
I thought you were going to say his name is Pete Peters.
No.
Okay.
So he was the original Pete.
Okay.
And then I have a brother who just, I have a younger brother who just retired from the Air Force,
okay.
Lieutenant Colonel, and he is Pete Peters. Now his real name is Bruce. Okay. So I can see why he didn't do that. And my real name is Jeff. And I never have liked that name either. So I don't know. There's Pete, you know, Pete. But
so it's just a family name, but it's a family nickname.
Just, yeah, but I mean, when I hear Pete, I think of my dad.
Damn.
Now, how close was I with my dad? I was so close that my dad was my best man in my wedding.
Really?
Yep.
Wow.
Yep, I had no one closer than him.
That is crazy.
Mm-hmm.
To think, because I mean, I just lost my dad, and we weren't all that close. So to like hear that, like that's something that I would strive for with my son.
Oh, gotcha.
You know,
mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that's and you know what's sad? This is confession here.
Yeah,
this is sad. I think because of what I did for all you guys, my students, my own son got a little screwed over. Because I remember distinctly one time saying something. My daughter was in the car, and I remember saying something about, I've got to go and do something with my kids. And then she said, I thought we were your kids.
Ooh.
I know.
Ooh.
Down deep.
That cuts.
But I've always been so dedicated to my students that I know Jake and Jenny probably
suffered
Jake,
a little bit
yeah.
for it.
Yeah. Now, when Jake, okay, Jenny went to Gila Ridge, mm-hmm. but Jake always wanted to be a Ram, always wanted to go with dad to school.
Yeah.
Loved, you know, and so when he got here, he's not what I would call necessarily, you know, the stucco kind of kid, because mm-hmm. he's always kind of quiet
yeah.
and stuff, even though he's a stand up comedian, which just blew our minds when he wanted to do it. But I've always thought, he was president of Key Club both years, junior and senior year. He
nice.
Got into stucco. He went to, you know, camp and all that. But I really, if I ever could do it all over again, I would definitely try to correct that.
Cause yeah.
I just know he got short end.
He got a sour deal.
Yeah. Yeah. You know,
than what could have been provided. And that's,
yeah,
yeah man, that's very honest of you. And
you know, yeah, he yeah. came to campus and shared his dad, you know, with a lot of kids.
Yeah, wow.
Now, he did get to go on trips with us that maybe other kids, but it's done. I'm not sure if the trade-off was fair.
Yeah, because he gets to go and be around, but are the connections still the same? But that's the fine line.
And a couple kids, like we talked about a Dagan. You know, Dagan was my president, but he was president when you were a freshman.
Yeah.
So he became almost a member of our family. So Jake's always considered him one of his older brothers.
Mm.
You know, so I mean, that's a positive.
That's a positive. Yeah.
You know, and Dagan's still in our lives, you know. So, I mean, I'm not sure what Jake would say to all that, you know, but I do think he would probably say, yeah, he got screwed over.
Well, I'm sure if we're honest with ourselves mm-hmm. and do that, but then you can always, you know, try to look at the silver lining or, you know, mm-hmm. how it made him, you know, become a better, stronger person,
right.
You know, because yep. that's in its own form, somewhat adversity that mm-hmm. he had to deal with it. We all deal with it.
And he was
ways.
Thinking about teaching, you know, yeah. which I still think he'd make a great teacher. But,
yeah.
you know, he subbed in my class one time for freshman. And the next day he decided he didn't want to be a teacher. I really think he should try it again. But
yeah, we'll did you just throw him with the bad class or what?
No, you know, I was on the senior trip. And, you know, so it was at the end of the year and they were taking finals and, you know. He didn't have a good experience, and it's too bad because I think he's quiet, but he's very sarcastic and mm-hmm. just kind of, I think the kids would, you know, he would, I think be one of their favorites, you know, once he relaxes and opens up with you, cause he's so funny
yeah,
and so opinionated and very intelligent. But so I'm hoping maybe he'll try it, but who knows?
Yeah, do it. Cause he just moved up to Phoenix, right?
Yep. He's in Phoenix and he decided to just work for a while. He's got his associate degree. And he's excellent, like in writing and English and, you know, all that. And that's where I thought he was headed, but mm-hmm. I don't know. He also has just discovered investments and finance. So,
okay.
You know, and he enjoys doing that, you know, just reading and dabbling in that. So who knows?
Yeah, that could be, you know, lucrative.
Oh, yeah,
in a sense. Yeah.
Yeah, because you have to have a little, you know. One of my former students who I'm so proud of is Jay Mitzmeyer.
Yeah. Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
So Jay is, and Jay's, I was shout out to Jay. He's such a great backer of our freshman retreat and just Antelope. But you know, here's a kid who went to the Air Force Academy, and now he's you know doing his Air Force gig up in Las Vegas. He's working with drones and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then he started on the side his own investment company. He's doing quite well,
awesome.
And he's on TED Talks and different.
I've seen him.
Oh
on
my
panels.
God! Yeah, he's just phenomenal. You know, just if you like. Want to just read about him and see what he's doing. He's making a mark for himself.
Yeah, no, really. he's making big moves for sure. So yeah. that's always nice to see because again, we're from a small town, which
he's from Dayton,
me to the,
so I mean, it's kind of cool.
I remember my senior year when I was applying for scholarships, I was like, oh, student athlete of the year award. I was like, yeah, I'll throw my name into that. And
that's right.
And somehow
was that the Wendy's or what?
No, I don't remember whose it was.
Okay. So
it was held at the Orpheum Theater.
Okay,
and we got to go to the Diamondbacks game and go on the field and all that. But I was like, yeah, that's cool. I'm doing good things. I got good grades, right? And I was like the captain of everything I was in. So all right. And I remember Mr. Hill was just like, this is the one you're applying for out of all of them. I'm a busy man. but somehow I got selected and he came down and the guy was like, yo, you know, you guys for being a small school like this, he's like, you've had, it was me and then Skousen the year before. What was
it Daniel?
Name? No, not Jacob. Daryl Skousen?
There was a Daryl. There was a Bob.
He graduated in 05 because I was graduating in 06. Okay. I think it was that one. And he's like, yo, 2 years in a row, like you guys have had quality candidates up for that award. And needless to say, I lost out because I was going to school to be a firefighter. And the guy that won was already a volunteer firefighter up in Sholo.
That's
so
funny.
Oh, okay. This is your idol over here. This guy that's in the same grade as you.
That's still quite an honor, though. That's
it was
cool.
Fun. Heck yeah, it was fun. And you know, my parents are proud.
Oh,
you know, obviously,
yeah.
You know, we got to go up to Phoenix and do that whole thing. So, yeah. But yeah, I mean, this.
You know, I still
not
see,
to knock a small school like it produces.
Oh yeah, you know, kids tell me that all the time. You know, they want to go into the big school in town, and you know, we have too many success people we can point to. You know, we've sent kids to Yale and Harvard and Princeton and Stanford and, of course, U of A and ASU and all those.
Yeah.
But my point being, so much depends on the kid.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, if you have to have that natural drive inside of you.
Yes.
I can't take a kid and just say, okay, I'm going to make you a star. You know, I can't make you an academic star. You've got to, we can help you, but you've got to have that drive.
Yeah, that drive.
And you have to have that drive whether you're here or at Cibola. I mean, you have to have it.
Yeah.
Now, you do have the advanced classes, which do help you. Mm-hmm. I agree. Some of our kids, like I said, I have a kid who's at ASU right now who's pre-med. And, yeah, he had a little bit tough time in chemistry. You know, his background maybe wasn't as strong, but he survived, made him stronger. He's right in there. So, I mean, it's there.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it's,
now
it's
let's go back because I can see you as a firefighter. I always said that, didn't I? All through high school.
Yeah. That's always one that kind of stuck out.
Well, that and you always had a real, you have a natural wanting to help people.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I always saw you as that, you know, medic or fireman or something like that.
Yeah. I was wanting to do it and I was going to school for it and I was volunteering with Mesa Fire and then, just got really sloppy with showing up late, you know, because I was going out partying the night before.
Life.
And I think that was after I decided that I probably wasn't going to pursue it because that's when the recession hit.
Mm.
And so like there was all these layoffs. So the list to get on and, you know, is already long.
Impossible.
And then now the ones that got laid off, well, they go right to the top, right? Because they were already there. They're just waiting for funding. So it just looked like a uphill battle that I couldn't do. And I could have maybe moved down here or stayed down here or volunteered in high school here when I was here, but I just wasn't proactive about it.
Yeah.
And, but you know, I kind of like saddled in cause once I got laid off from the recession, I got to work at Guitar Center and then just kind of, you know, not got complacent because I'm in a good spot right now.
Yeah.
Like I wouldn't move up to management because, in selling, I've been doing it for 10 years. Like I'm making pretty good money
and
it's consistent and, you know, I don't have the manager title, so I don't have any of those responsibilities. So, I'm good, but I don't know at this point, I wouldn't pursue it. Just cause, you know, it's a big risk. I mean, especially right now up there, there's a big story on firefighters dying either on the job or from job related causes, and they're not getting the help. You know, it's just the same thing that's with sad. Like veterans, you know, it's like, hey, let's ship you off to war. And then when you come back and it's like, I need help for all the stuff I was exposed to over there. And then it's like, there's all this.
What, well, and then your Guitar Center too led you to, you know, your music.
Yeah, the music. Yeah. I really got into that.
DJ. Sure. Bobby. What's it?
Oh yeah, Bobby Brand New.
Yeah,
the hip hop group I was in. Yeah. He actually stopped by one time. Remember, we went to AWC when my brother was in the theater department. Yep. He was doing like the news channel. He's like, you guys want to come down and do an interview? And we brought the Mr. T lookalike. Yeah. That was Ken.
Oh yeah, I do remember. That. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
We stopped in. And that probably, you probably met him through Guitar Center, right? Or not?
No, I met him through actually Jose Canchola.
Oh, okay.
Who went here as well? But he. There was a lot of people that worked at Banner, the hospitals, and so they all, you know, got to know each other. And we needed a roommate, and he's like, "Well, I need a place to stay." Okay. And then he's like, "Oh, I'm a rapper," and I'm like, "Well, I play bass." He's like, "Well, let's play live." All right, cool. Just rolls right in. And I remember the first show we went to, we didn't have a DJ, and the guy DJing there was like looking around. He's like, "Well, these are the only guys playing live," and he's like, "These songs sound really good." And then we're like, hey, we need a DJ. He's like, yeah, I'm down. So we got our DJ after the first gig. And yeah, everything, you know, it was fun while it lasted for sure.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah. So
kind of cool.
Yeah. Everything happens for a reason. Oh, one thing I do want to touch on is like when you're talking about drive.
Let's go back to Jose for just a second.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to this advisor workshop on Monday where I'm going to be teaching Stucco advisors about some things they can do in the classroom. Uh-huh. And one thing that we did back when you were there was we did CD covers. And it's, you know, you make your own CD cover and it had a picture and your favorite music and stuff. Even though we don't do CD covers anymore, you can, vinyl's coming back, you
vinyl,
know, so you can change
magazine
it.
Cover.
So anyway, one that I pulled out of my closet to take along as an example was Jose's.
Yeah.
So when you see him, I'll have to get it.
Do
to
you
him.
Have it? You have it ready?
Yeah. I have it right over here.
Yeah, go grab. Wait, you got headphones on. Easy. Go get it.
I'm not used to this.
Yeah, get it.
I have yours in my closet somewhere.
Bring a candy bar while you're at it. Just messing.
I swear to God, I have this.
There it is. Got a Mexico soccer player party mix too. He DJs now.
Did I just have my big body walk across the camera?
Oh, probably.
Okay. Is that crazy?
Yeah, this is great.
You know, these closets are filled. I don't know if you remember my, I used to do an I Believe thing where you had to profile and stuff. You know, I have a bunch of those. So I'm going to have to look through those. You know, something else I started here.
Do it.
Is we took some old lockers, okay? The old lockers from the locker room.
Yeah.
And made a time capsule. And we're filling it. I think we started about 5 years ago. So we collect stuff from the class, and you know, from freshman through senior, and then we stick it in there, and then we put a padlock on it, and then I have a tag, you know, I go to and get it engraved, and it says class of 2015. Mm. And then at their 10 year, they can break the padlock and see some of that old stuff they did, you know, and I put newspapers in there. And,
you have little treasures in here for sure.
Oh, I can't even imagine, you know, what's all in here.
Memories. Yeah. Yep. Well, because what's in these cabinets? Just more photos, right?
Uh-huh. And then in my office, I have two big milk crates, and those are just filled. And a lot of times what I'll do when I'm here on a Saturday, Sunday by myself is I just kind of reach down, mix them all up, and I'll pull a picture out and say, okay, who in the hell are these? You know, try to think, who are these kids and stuff? Yeah.
Yeah.
I should bring one out later. We'll see if we...
We'll cruise through it. Yeah,
See what, I mean, it really is fun, and my kids have fun because they'll see their older brothers, their dad, their mom, their aunt. Well, yeah, their aunt. You know, and it's fun.
And see the aunt's first husband, second husband, third husband.
And this, I've always said, I wished I would have kept, you know, notes because God, they're, you know, I bet I could tell some kids things about their parents.
Yeah,
that would be like,
I'd be like, hey, oh, they're trying to discipline you about this. Uh-huh. Well, here's this.
Yeah. And it, you know what's crazy too is I've had a few kids through the years where like I was like right now I have a kid named Gavin Rivera. He's a little freshman and mm-hmm. he's on my stucco. His dad, Joe Rivera,
yeah,
was just one of my favorite kids in junior high in Wellton.
Uh-huh.
Like oh, did some, shit. You know, he always hung out and he did favors, you know, just lots of stuff, you know. And here his son now, you know, is in stucco working with Pete. You know, it's just, it's
and,
weird.
And you see some of his traits? You see
oh,
some
God.
Of the traits in there?
Yeah, because he has an older brother who's a senior.
Okay.
And I knew that that was Joe's kid. And he was, you know, he's a really good writer. He's very creative. And but Gavin is like a little spitting image.
Yeah.
It's just crazy. Yeah. So that happens every once in a while is what I'm saying, you know. I'll like, hey, your dad was, you know, in my stucco or your dad was in this. And then now here he is, you know.
Well, when you're doing
it's
it,
it's crazy.
As long as you have, and as well as you,
well,
you do it.
Well, and
you know?
In one spot, you know,
yeah,
that's
exactly,
the key. You
yeah.
know, so when you stay 40 years in one little community, it's going to happen.
You're part of it. Well, I always told people, I was like, I don't know what the school's going to do when they lose Blabe and you. And Blabe's been gone for, what, 9 years?
Yeah. But somebody came in.
Yeah,
you know?
It comes in, for
I
sure.
mean, they went, they... We had a couple of weird years with football,
yeah.
no doubt, like the black jersey incident. But, you know, now we have a coach who was willing to stay and build the program. And, you know, Malden's doing great.
Yeah.
Hear, they call it the Malden era.
Malden
and
era.
They have Dateland, or you have the Blabe era, you know. So, I mean, there'll be somebody, you
yeah.
know. And they may not do, that's why I'm saying, I hope they continue the freshman retreat and a couple things. But otherwise, yeah. Change it.
Well, I think you should have
do
the veto
things.
Power on like who's coming in here. Is it?
No. I already have teachers who want my, you know, I have painted ceilings. They want my painted ceilings.
Your painted ceilings.
You know.
I mean, all the posters.
No, well, those things are actual painted. You know?
Oh shoot!
Yeah, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, and they're really cool.
Oh dang! Who
yeah.
did those?
Carly. Gomez, and she's in the Air Force now, but she's such a good artist.
Is that her up there?
She is up there. Yep. Yep.
Hey, nice. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I thought there were posters.
I took
really
advantage
good.
Of her before she left. Cause yeah, she could just, she was just awesome. I'd like to do more. So maybe she'll get on a leave and come home. Yeah.
You're like there's breakfast at the whistle shop.
I know,
whistle stop. Yeah.
Free. Good little breakfast.
Yeah. It was good breakfast. Heck yeah.
But yeah, you're right though. If these walls could talk,
there's some other walls I'm curious about in here.
I know. Trust me, I know.
We have to do the post retirement cast.
Yes, where, that's for much later.
Where you can really divulge some of those
secrets.
Yeah. Oh man, it's awesome. It feels good to be back in you know where I spent. You know, my formative years, mm-hmm. you know.
Well, you definitely didn't let any grass grow under your feet here.
No.
You were pretty active.
Yeah, yeah, which, you know, you get shy. Yeah, like I didn't want to play football originally, and then I got talked into that, and I was like, I loved it, you know, through the few concussions that I'm sure I had. Like, I didn't get involved into stucco till like my junior year, you know, just like, well, what's that all about? Well, I don't know.
I know.
You
know. How come? What was that? I don't remember.
Yeah. I'm a little shy. I'm yeah. a little, you know, now
how
I'm like,
get,
hey,
how did
jump.
We get you involved?
I don't remember.
Was that your
I
teacher
think it was
that
Key
year?
Club.
Oh, Key Club. Okay.
Key Club. And then I was like, well, I can do this.
Because I remember Nacho was more.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Nacho. And I think Fern too.
Yeah.
Was in there.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I was a little bit of a weirdo.
You tagged along with him and
yeah,
got bit. By the spirit.
Yeah, and it was tons of fun, you know, going out. Like you said, you had privileges, you know, by being the co-sponsor. What would you say mm-hmm. the title is?
Yeah, associate director.
But yeah, where you know we got to visit these other schools, mm-hmm. you know.
Oh yeah, we probably did some school exchanges mm-hmm. too.
Yeah, yeah.
God, I love those. Are fun too.
Yeah,
I still do those once in a while, but yeah.
Yeah. No, it's it was.
I
fun.
Think our kids learn so much by. You know, just interacting with other schools.
And oh, well, actually, let me, what do you think about this? This is what I have in mind as my plan for my kids mm-hmm. when they're graduating. Mm-hmm. So I hope to have put away, you know, some money to help them to go to college, a college mm-hmm. fund. Mm-hmm. But then I'm going to say, hey, this is your college fund. go to school if that's what you want.
If that's
my recommendation for you is to take a year and a half to 3 years, don't bother doing schooling,
right,
and go travel the world, yep, learn about the world, because ultimately that's going to teach you about yourself.
Oh, yeah.
You're able to find yourself, mm-hmm, and then come back once you've kind of gotten all that gathered, mm-hmm, and if you haven't, well, obviously, you know, maybe there's more work to do, yeah, but then you might have a better idea of where you want to go, what you want to do, other than, well, everybody else is going to school and everybody's telling me to go to school, so just go to college and this, right, and that. It's getting to the point where the college degree,
well, I think that's where we make our mistakes. We think everybody needs to go to college,
yeah,
and I totally disagree.
Yeah,
there's just so many other avenues. And then the other thing is, yes, traveling. That's why when parents would say, you know, we're thinking we've got to go take this trip, they're going to be gone for a week, and I'm just like, I'm not going to give you any homework, just go and enjoy the trip, because they're going to get much more out of just traveling.
Yeah, being exposed to the world.
Oh, yeah. Teaches you tolerance, for one thing.
Yes.
And that's lacking. So, yeah, I agree. I just, yeah, just live life and explore what's out there. Because, mm-hmm, some kids are lucky. You know, they always say, because I have these kids who, you know, they're worried because they don't know what they're going to do when they graduate. Because I knew I wanted to be a teacher since sixth grade.
Oh, wow.
So, I mean, it was just like, I'm going to be a teacher. That's what I want to be.
Yeah.
You know, and we have kids like that. You know, they want to be a nurse or whatever.
For sure.
But I do feel the frustration of a kid who just, because we push and we feel like, okay, their freshman year, we're starting them on a career path already. You know, we're doing packets already.
Yeah.
And it's just like, slow down, you know, live life, enjoy it, see what you want, you know.
That brings me back around to what I was going to say before we got onto to Canchola, on the drive part. And it was well-intentioned, and you even told me this a few times. And I tell people, it's like, to me now, looking back, it was bad advice, but well-intended, where it's like, oh, you're young. You're young. You got time. Mm-hmm. You're young. Yes, yes and no, because mm-hmm, I'm still young. 31.
You are definitely young. Oh my God, yeah.
But it was like, I kind of got complacent and I was like, I was, you know, relaxed and just like, mm-hmm, well, I'm just kind of go through the motions, instead of now, like, this is kind of like, well, what am I doing? What do I want to do? And it's what a lot of people do lack, is they lack purpose. That's right. That's where a lot of depression comes from.
Well, you said two things there. So, like, if you're telling your kids to go out and travel and see what's out there, that's good advice.
Yeah.
But if it's just go out there, get a job for a while, then yeah. Because what happens is we get a car payment.
Yeah.
We get an apartment payment. We get a girlfriend, mm-hmm, or boyfriend. And, you know, pretty soon we have payments. And then it's like,
And then you're tied down to that. Yeah.
Yeah. So there's a difference there. You know, go out and explore the world, grow up a little bit, maybe even do a military, you know, for a couple of years. There's nothing wrong with that.
Mm-hmm.
But not just go out and start working. No. Because, that's where so many kids make their mistakes pretty soon. You know, especially kids who don't have much. You know, all of a sudden now I have a car.
Yeah.
And I can go buy, you know, Foot Locker. And
you have the money to give you freedom.
Yeah.
You see this money, so you're like, what's giving me freedom?
Can I go back to being poor again and go to college? Or have I, I'm accustomed to this now.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's a...
It's tough. And I tell people, too, like, I was at my uncle's last night, you know, having, you know, food and drinks and hanging out. And my cousin, I think she's a junior or a sophomore. Maybe she's a senior. I'm not sure. But I was... I just fucking lost my train of thought. Oh, kids. I was like, I love my kids, but...
I haven't said the word fuck yet, have I? You beat me to it.
Fuck. Yeah, hell yeah. I was like, don't have kids. She's like, oh, I don't want kids. I was like, good. I was like, don't have them. If you're going to get kids, I think I was like, wait till you're at least 30 before you get married or have kids, I said.
Right.
I was like, but really? I was like, don't. She's like, oh, I don't want kids. I was like, cool. And if you do, adopt. Mm. You guys adopted, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I was like, yeah, if you do adopt, because to me, like, that's the most noble thing. And I have my own kids. I made my own kids.
Right.
And that's selfish. It's selfish to bring, in my opinion, you know, this is looking at it black and white. Obviously, it's not black and white, but it is selfish to bring a life into the world. Not saying that the world is really all that bad, but there's a lot in there. Mm-hmm. And there's kids out there that need loving homes.
Definitely.
And you could step up by... making that call. Mm-hmm. So I say, A, for one, don't have adopt. This is my my tiered hierarchy. Is that what it's called?
Right. Yeah. My train adopt of thought anyway. Yep.
Don't have kids, and then whatever else, and then down here is like have your own kids. Like
yeah. Well, so, here's a couple of thoughts. So we did adopt, but I had this same opinion. You know, wait till the 30s, because man, when my 30s, if people always ask, would you ever go back to high school? I would go back to college because I loved it. I'd never go back to high school, but my favorite time period of ever was my 30s.
Uh-huh.
Loved my 30s because you're kind of set. You're making some money and you're doing what you want and you're professional, blah, blah, blah. But I think I waited too long for kids because, you know, when Jake would want to jump on my shoulders, it was like, oh, dude, slow down there. So I would be cautious on that part.
Yeah.
But here's what happened. Okay. This is I don't know if it's an interesting story, but I had two juniors, both really cool kids, Leo and a Mo, Moe says. So Leo, He lived in Tacna with his parents and he was, you know, had a big family. And he told me, he says, my family's, this was the spring of the junior year. He said, my family, I think, is moving to Oregon.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, oh, that's really sad. I said, because my parents moved when I was going to be a senior.
Oh, okay.
And that's tough.
Yeah.
You know, I stayed behind and stayed with a friend so I could go to my high school. Oh, so I told him, I said, you know, if that happens and you want to stay, you know, Jane and I, you can definitely live with us. Didn't think a thing of it. Then this kid joins our school named Moises. He moved here from Panama to live with his uncle in Wellton.
Mm-hmm.
He had never met his uncle, never met him. His just mom wanted to send him to the States.
Yeah.
Well, I was living in Wellton at the time. Like I told you, he came over almost every day because him and his uncle, for whatever reason, you know, just wasn't a good situation.
Mm-hmm.
And so in the summer, Jane and I went and stayed at our house, you know, that I was telling you about. And I said, why don't you come up and just stay with us for a while? You know, just, you know. So he came up and stayed, I don't know how many weeks, and Jane fell in love with him. He's the neatest kid. So make a long story short, he moved in with us in August of that year.
Yeah.
And I had forgotten about Leo. Leo moved in with us. So here's Jane. Okay, Jane's teaching kindergarten, first grade, whatever. And I'm, you know, we've had no kids. We have that little two-bedroom house in Wellton. All of a sudden, I have two big senior boys sharing a room, eating breakfast cereal out of mixing bowls because they never fill up. And Jane and I just loved it.
Yeah.
So we said, oh, we're missing out on something. So that's what got us thinking about adopting and kids and just, you know.
Yeah.
So if those two boys hadn't moved in, Mo ended up staying. He went 2 years AWC. So he stayed quite a while.
Yeah.
Taught him how to drive, got him a car. You know, I mean, he just became my son.
Yeah.
And then Leo, now his parents moved back after Christmas. So he moved out. He was only with us a semester. But he won state for Antelope. I remember getting up in the morning, taking him out to like where Kestrels live, and then he would run home. You know, I'd get up in the mornings, and you know, he was just a member of our family.
Yeah.
So those two boys changed our lives.
Wow.
Yeah.
You still contact?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Well, Leo, he's on Facebook, but Mo is always Mo's another one who's like just always my son. You know, I was his best man in his wedding.
Oh shit.
Yeah, he lives in Dallas. He's doing awesome. His daughter, who I can, you know, he has a daughter and son. We kind of consider them grandkids.
Yeah.
She came out and went to I took her to Stuco Camp because she's a junior in high school in Dallas. And
oh, cool.
She had a blast.
Awesome.
So he's doing great. But those two guys definitely changed our lives.
Yeah. So how old are your two kids when they were adopted?
Jenny, they were both babies. Jenny was probably 6 months old because she got caught in the system. Her grandparents had control of her, but they didn't realize it. And so we had to go through some legal things to get her because her mom had problems. Jake was born on a Thursday and brought him home Friday.
So, wow.
Yeah. I had a niece and two nephews who came out from Minnesota their senior year. So if they came out, I took them to LA. So we were in LA and we had tickets to the Tonight Show. And then Jane called and said, Jake's coming. You got to, you know, so we skipped the Tonight Show and went back home. But it was, yeah, it was over there. It was crazy. And that was the same trip I met O.J. Simpson.
You met the Juice?
The Juice. He was outside fixing his daughter's bike. And we drove by, and because we were in Beverly Hills, and we went to see his place. And then we were like, damn, is that him? So we backed up, and we rolled the window down. And we go, O.J., can we get a picture? He said, yeah. He was fixing the bike. His hands were greasy. I have a picture in my, I keep it in my office because people would get pissed off. Is that OJ? I'm like, yeah, that's OJ. But I have the picture in there.
What?
You can see he has his arm around us, but he doesn't touch us because his hands are greasy.
Yeah.
And then I drove away. And back then we had TVs and we did the news. And I had the school camera in my trunk. How cool would that have been for OJ to say, hey, guys.
Yeah, stay in school.
Hey, Antelope Brands. Antelope Brands. But that was weird.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, so we rushed home, and Jake came that very next day.
Dang.
Mm-hmm.
That's
pretty
cool, man.
Pretty cool. Too fun.
The Juice.
And the other celebrity I have up, Will. Now, Will was on a Stuco trip, too. We were all in Philadelphia flying home.
And you were in Philadelphia and ran into fucking Will Smith.
Yeah, he was at the airport. We were flying to Phoenix. He was flying back to L.A. because he was filming Fresh Prince. He was just a kid.
Yeah.
And I had like Annie Chavarria, Adrian Manriquez. I had several Antelope kids. He spent about 20 minutes with us.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, because so he couldn't have been, what, more than, what, 23 or
so? Oh, my God. Yeah, he's young. Yeah, young. And there was a show, you won't get this, but there was a show right at the same time, pretty popular, called Blossom.
Blossom. Mm-mm.
And it's the girl from, she was in The Big Bang Theory, too. But she had a TV show, very popular. So that was my lead into him. I said, you know, Will, I said, next to Blossom, yours is my favorite show. He just started laughing. He goes, oh, yeah. But yeah, he was really nice to the kids that day.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yep.
Because I can imagine that being, you know, that's a tough gig, being you know, famous mm-hmm. on that level where it's like people are constantly, like, oh, come on.
I mean, he's not like he is now. But
so, yeah, exactly. You're right. But like OJ, like, imagine you being outside fixing Jenny's bike.
Oh, I know.
And then this random car comes up. It's like, hey, can we get a picture? And you're like, dude, I'm trying to fix my daughter's car.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it takes, you know, a lot, in my opinion.
Especially, you know, because this was after, you know, the trial and everything. So, I mean, it was, you know, I didn't know who OJ was.
Yeah.
So.
Dang, Pete. You could have got.
I know.
You should have. What if you, what's Jake's middle name? What if you named him after
that? I know. So, yeah, I did him a disservice. He has my middle name. But now, just to set, that house is gone. They had so much traffic, you know, at his drive-by in his house and, you know, where the Bronco was, that they tore it down.
Really? I didn't know that.
It's no longer there.
When was that?
Eesh, I don't know. I'd have to look.
Wow, damn. I didn't know that. Because isn't there, there's another house, right? The Bonet Ramsey, that house is still up for sale and nobody ever buys
it. That's in Denver, though.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who'd want it? Yeah. And what's the story there? Who knows?
I get chills,
who
man.
Who knows? I know. It's scary good. Stuff.
Yeah.
Scary, scary. Mm. Do you remember the smart girl, Elizabeth Smart, the one who was kidnapped in Utah, and then she was kept for many years, and it turns out she was right in the area, but in the backyard, whatever. Anyway, her dad's going to be in Yuma in the next 2 weeks for a talk.
Oh, really?
I thought, I don't know where we're going on that, but I'm just saying, I thought he would have a compelling story.
Yeah, oh, for sure. For sure. That'd be interesting. Get on that.
I know.
Crazy. Like, put the mic in his face.
I know.
What do you got to say? Who are you?
I took the kids the other day to the VFW, you know, for the celebration. I don't know if you'd call it a celebration, but the remembrance, I should say, is a better word for missing in action, because they do it once ever in September. And I've always thought, you know, it sounds weird, but I would almost rather know my child is dead than to always live for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
Where is my kid? What happened to him? I don't know. It's weird to think about.
You need closure. It's like like going to the doctors because you're sick, and they're like, "Well, you're sick." We're like, "But why?" I need to know. Like, even if it's something. Cancer, at least you're like, "Well, we know what it is.
Right.
We know how to battle it." Yeah. just the unknowing for sure is what scares us. And that's where religion comes from. And of course, religion pops up on my podcast. No, it's really just religion, trying to make sense of everything.
Religion is so, I just had a talk the other day with one of my students who's, you know, just really inquisitive and smart. And he's one of those kids that could go in so many directions. Oh my God, the kid's so smart. But I was like, how do you, because he's taking lessons, or not, well, I don't know what you call it, lessons in the Catholic Church, whatever you call it, you know. And it's so hard bridging that gap between being intelligent, you know, science.
Yeah.
And then believing, you know, that
the literal
stuff, the stuff they teach you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then the people that do take it literally, you know, like, yes, there was an ark, and yes, they put two animals on, and yes, this guy was swallowed by the whale.
Yeah.
And it's so, you know, the contrasting. So I tell kids, Jane is very strong Catholic.
Okay.
Always has been.
Yeah.
Always will be. So when we got married, now this is hard to believe too, but when we got married back in 1972, I had to get, first of all, I had to get permission from my parents because I was 20. I wasn't 21 yet.
Ah.
And Jane didn't because girls matured, you know, more. So it was so weird that she could get married, but I had to get permission.
Yeah.
It was also weird that my mom took Jane aside and said, are you sure you want to marry him? Because, you know, he's bipolar or something's wrong with it. So that I always thought, Mom, what the hell? But where does it go? Oh, so I took lessons because I wasn't raised Catholic. But after about, I don't know, 5 meetings, I told Jane, I said, this is nothing I can believe in. You know, I just.
Yeah.
So we made agreement, you know, if we ever did have kids, I would let, because religion wasn't that important to me. I'm spiritual, but not organized religion. I just think it's so fake and misguided. But I said, I'll definitely let the kids. So our kids were both raised Catholic and confirmed, and neither of them are with the church anymore.
Yeah.
But Jane still is very strong.
Yeah. But
I don't know. I just think there's so much, I don't know, fake. I don't know. What do you call it? It bothers me that they're just like, the abuse of kids and
especially the Catholic, and then also that, of course,
and then even TV evangelists, you know, they wear the $300 suits and the big houses and the planes, and it's just there's very Billy Graham. I guess I respected him, but there's very few that you can really respect.
Was he the one with the earpiece though? I'm trying to remember.
I don't think so.
I don't remember, but yeah, those the prosperity gospel: give to me and it will be unto you tenfold or whatnot. No, for sure. It's. I mean, there's the quote where it's like religion is used by. What was it as like a manipulation tool by some, and then
there's always the famous line, you know, if there isn't a God, man would have to create one, because I mean it's what, you know, it gives us hope that life isn't, you know, we're not going to 80 years and then we go to the ground, you know.
Yeah.
So I mean, man needs something.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah, and you're looking for, you're trying to make, again, reason. You're trying to make logic out of situations that a lot of times there really just isn't. Mm-hmm. And then when we're not just smart to understand it, like there's the term, like the God of the gaps, that the gap is getting smaller and smaller as technology progresses because we're able to understand more about our world. Yep. So
that's why I've always said, you know, nowadays, if I wasn't a teacher, an occupation that's kind of new is life coaches.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Joel Osteen and some of them, if I go into it as I'm listening to him as a life coach and I can get a lesson from him, that's more my angle.
Yeah, for sure.
Not like you're going to salvation and this is what's going to get me to heaven and stuff. Mm-hmm. It's what's going to help me be a better person here. And if there's a reward afterwards, great, you know.
Yeah.
But I've always thought that would be, at first, when you think about it, you're like, oh, you have a life coach. But then I kind of see the value in it, too.
For sure.
Mm-hmm.
For sure.
So I've always thought that would be kind of a cool occupation.
Yeah.
You know, and helping people just become a better person. And that's, well, I mean, I guess teachers are anyway, in a way.
But, yeah, exactly.
But you know what I mean? Just I just think that's an interesting career choice now in the new era.
Well, and then it's like the people is like, well, what are your credentials to be a life
right,
coach?
Right.
What are we talking about here? Did you just wake up one day and it's like, I'm going to tell people how to live their lives?
Yeah. It is. It's crazy, isn't it?
It is a wacky world already, though. So.
Yeah. But even like what you're doing here, you know, that's just helping people. You know, they listen to it.
And
they, yeah, of course it does. You know, because, I mean, you're free to take all this stuff in, and then how you digest it is up to you.
How you turn it around and send it out into the world.
You know, you'd have to decipher it. I tell my kids, I don't know if you remember this, but my biggest goal is to teach them to be sharp, critical observers. I mean, it's important to learn math and English and all the other things we teach.
Yep.
But the most important thing is when you leave here or wherever, you know, is to become sharp, critical observers. Because, you know, it's like I always tell the kids, if all you're listening to is CNN, you're going to get one, or Fox or whoever.
Yeah.
You've got to really decipher, because this, I don't know what the statistics are, but how many billboards you see and how much stuff is thrown into your ear.
Trying to persuade you.
Every day, yes, for everything. You know,
it should always be, it's like, what's this angle? What's this poster trying to get across? Or what's this commercial? Mm-hmm. Like, who benefits from this information?
Yeah.
And I guess that's the skeptical side, that you should approach most things with certain levels of skepticism, not just complete skepticism, but, you know, you have to question it.
Yeah. Yeah. I think, especially in this, you know, in the political era that we live in, it's just, you know, it behooves you to,
Yeah,
question,
and especially if you see something to it, which I've been trying to do lately, it's like if you see something, you're like, well, yeah, I agree with that. And so 100 times, and it's like, well, wait, kind of analyze that. Why do you agree with that? Because I love to play devil's advocate with other people. Like, even if I agree with them, like out the gate, I'll just kind of be like, well, you know, what about this and what about that, right? And it hasn't been too good for the marriage, right? Because sometimes she just needs me to like hold the punching bag for her.
Yeah.
Whereas a lot of times I'm just like, well, do you think that maybe this person, boom, and it's like, what are you doing? Like, can't you just like talk shit with me for a little bit? I was like, okay, that's what you need. Like, I'm always trying to like, you know, reason too much.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And I've always tried anyway to keep my own opinions out of the classroom.
Yeah,
which is hard.
It's hard
because, you know, kids, especially high school kids, you know, what do you think about Trump? What do you think about Hillary? You know, all that stuff. And especially when I taught government, we used to do the political spectrum, you know, liberal, conservative. And so at the end of the year, if a kid doesn't know how I'm voting, I always consider that a success, you know, that I've, because you do devil's advocate. You know, they come in and they're very staunch this, you know, whatever the issue is, gun control or abortion or whatever. And you just have to kind of play devil's advocate so you get both sides out there, you know?
Yeah.
So they, oh, I never thought about that.
Exactly.
Before.
That's thing. That's what I try to get when I talk to people. Like, that's like what I get here.
Yep.
Like, I didn't think of it like that, or I never saw that angle. Mm-hmm. And that's the benefit of multiple perspectives.
Because a lot of times in the classroom, especially the younger kids, you're really hearing their parents' conversation from the dinner table.
Yep.
You know, or, you know, from their upbringing. And so, in a way, it's kind of a fine line, you know. It's like, that's not what my dad says. And I'm like, well. You can't just say your dad's full of shit. You got to say, well, maybe you should ask dad this.
And it's, well, you're asking me to question my feelings.
Yeah. And sometimes they'll change mine, you know, but it's just, that's just part of teaching.
Yeah.
It's funny. You gotta,
seeing that.
Oh, role models.
Oh, it's awesome.
Is your breakfast settling in?
I think so.
Getting tired?
No. What time is it?
I don't even know.
What time you gotta leave?
Oh. Whenever, sometime.
I don't want to hold you up.
Sometime this afternoon. How long have we been talking?
I don't know. I don't know how to tell time on that thing.
Oh, okay.
Because it's a music production tool.
Oh, okay.
It's a music production tool, so it counts like bars, you know, frame.
Yeah.
And I can't figure out how to change it to just time. So.
That's okay.
It's a good
Whenever you're ready. But I do think, take this under advisement. I think this would be fun with the three amigos.
Okay.
Can we please do that?
Yeah, I think we can make that happen.
And maybe I can be the host, or I'll be the substitute host that time. I'll be the Jimmy Fallon. But you guys would just bring back so many memories. That would be so fun.
Yeah, I would love to. Obviously, the main one to coordinate with would be Fern, because he's stationed in Texas right now.
Oh, he's in Texas. I thought he was in I've lost
No, track. They just moved. No, they just moved like 2 months ago.
We're at in Texas, do you know?
No.
Okay.
I don't love him that much. I know.
That's true. The show may suck. Maybe we'll go with Jose.
Yeah. No, that would be fun. It's just fun. Like, these are conversations that would happen, like, this morning, you know, over some coffee and breakfast.
Definitely.
Or, you know, in the evening over some drinks. Mm-hmm. Or in the late evenings over some heroin, you know. Just
never know.
Yeah. it's just,
I always have kids ask me, you gonna get high with me after I graduate? I'm like, dude,
yeah, you don't partake, right?
I have, uh-huh. But not for a while.
Yeah. Just some good old alcohol.
That might be some stories after I retire. Yeah.
Hey.
But definitely not with kids. Oh my God. No. Yeah. But I do get them that, you know.
Yeah.
Crazy, crazy.
Well, they want to do that. They want to like break down that barrier.
Oh, sure.
Because I was there. I was like, hey, you know, it'd be fun to, you know, party with this,
exactly.
this teacher or that teacher. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So, speaking of teachers, now you're going to do Coach Blabe in one of your installments. So you're going to have to definitely ask him about the Pete and Blabe. He was a hoot to work with.
Yeah.
And I wonder if he remembers one time I threw up on his basketballs. You'll have to. I don't know if he even remembers that.
Oh,
he had his office over here in this one wing, and I couldn't make it to the bathroom. And I went in, and he had a, if I remember right, it was like a trash can right there. So I went for that, and his little bag of balls was right by it. I don't know why that stands out. But him and I had a love hate, you know, because Stuka was always, you know, I was taking his kids for spear conferences or some other.
Oh, I experienced that. Oh,
yeah. And I still have that to this day with coaches, you know, and just it's so hard because, you know, kids want to do it all.
Yeah.
And I love my program and they love their program. And mm-hmm. But Blabe was just so much fun to work with. I mean, in all truth and honesty, he was just, you know, he's a big old guy who just was like, but he was just so mellow and cool. And
it was awesome when you could break down his seriousness and get, you know, a laugh out of him. Or
so here's what I want you to do. Make sure on his segment that he tells you his story. And I'm not going to get the word right, but it's about a guy in Africa, and he has a choice between... He'll know. Just tell him the famous joke that Pete loves, and I'm pretty sure he'll remember it, because,
it's a famous
joke. But first, and then whatever the word is, I can never... He's the only one that can tell it.
Yeah.
It's a Blabe joke.
Oh, I'll get him.
Oh, yeah.
I'll get him.
Seriously, remember that, though, because you'll get a kick out of it.
Yeah. No, there's lots of key points I want to... touch on with him. I think he punched out one of the KISS members. I think one time he was.
Oh yeah, he took. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Back
in New York.
New York.
Yeah.
Yeah. I remember one time, the kids that lived with me, Mo and Leo.
Yeah.
Okay, we were playing Maricopa.
Okay.
And something happened during the game, and I think it had something to do. I don't know what it was, but all I remember is after the game, usually the boys would ride home with Jane and I, mm-hmm. but they said, no, you have to pick the kids up at Peter's corner, which is, you know, like 15 miles down the road. So they brought the Antelope bus up right next to the locker room. And then the kids had to come out of the locker room, get on the bus. And I remember Blabe had to pull a Maricopa kid away, cause he was coming in to do something. And then they took the bus way 20 miles, stopped, and then the kids all could go with their parents.
Why?
Yeah, something happened that game.
Oh.
I don't know, on the field. And there were really tensions. Yeah, it was crazy.
Oh. That was a little bit of a rivalry, right? Until Maricopa got too big.
Tigas got too big, yeah.
Yeah.
And then we had a little bit of a rivalry with YC, and then they just kind of, you know.
They
just have had some lean years, but.
Yeah.
Yeah, there. Somebody was bringing that up the other day, and I don't remember when this was with you. But 1 year, and you have to give them, you know, kudos for doing that. But 1 year, they went up on the mountain and put YC up there and lit
it up.
That was
my senior year.
Oh, was it your senior year? And oh my God,
yep.
You'd think all hell broke loose.
Yeah, that was.
I mean, it just pissed us off. But I mean, you have to admit that was pretty dang resourceful. It's crazy.
Yeah, they got us on that one for sure.
Oh my God. And then we retaliated, which is, you know, we did some damage, which is
I don't remember what that was. Something wasn't like manure or something.
Well, I think it was even more than that. Something harmful on their field. Yeah. Ooh. I don't remember what it was.
Yeah.
But
rivalries.
Yes.
High school rivalries.
Yep. 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 So, and we started the, speaking of, now a good thing, we started the Yuma County get together and Antelope started that.
Oh, nice.
And that's still going strong.
So what does that entail though?
That is, where we bring all the student councils together.
Okay.
And we have a day of, you know, guest speakers and workshops and we just hosted it last year. And then Cibola hosts it this year. But we started that many, many years ago.
Yeah.
Yep. And it's still going strong.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Because I really want to teach these kids that just because they're from Antelope, they can still hold their heads up high. Just because we're smaller, we're just as good as any other school. And that's just, you know, it just bugs me when they don't have that
feeling. As I go through life, and, you know, being exposed to more and more people out there. And I think about, you know, the quality of people I went to school with and was around. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And just like,
yeah,
you know, in this day and age, I could imagine, okay, maybe if it was like the 1950s or 60s, you're in from a small town, there's a definitely different vibe.
Right.
But when I grew up, I mean, we had satellite, there was internet was around.
Oh, yeah.
So none of this stuff, like I'm surprised, like when some people from the city, I was like, you never watched this or you never heard of this or this or that. And I'm like, how? Like this information is out there.
Yep.
So in this day and age, all of it's available to you. And it really... you know, just showcases that if you're open to this information and really, like you said, thinking critically and all that, like you hold your head up.
Oh yeah,
for sure,
definitely. Yep. I don't know. I would put our kids up against anybody. You know, and I've had such great Stuco leaders through the years. So yeah, definitely. You're one of them.
Appreciate it. We'll end on that note. No, I'm just playing. I just was fishing for that one compliment.
There you go.
Just playing. That's great, man. So
I have enjoyed it. It's been fun.
Are you because we gotta know when the end date is. This is gonna be a big party for old Jeff Peters.
Okay. I keep telling you about this president I have who's at ASU, Zevin, and I always said I would retire when Zevin graduates. Well, then I had a class that was just phenomenal.
Yeah.
The kids that are seniors this year, it's just a phenomenal class. I just really some strong kids in there. So I just kind of decided, well, I'll stay through them. And then it got to the point where it's kind of like become a joke. When are you retiring? I don't know, you know?
Yeah.
So I just told Jane, I said, I'm not going to say anything till after Christmas. I'll see how I'm feeling.
Yeah.
You know? And like I've always said, as long as I'm coming over the mountain with a smile and I'm enjoying it, you know, I'm fine. So, I mean, I still like it. I still have fun.
You still got the energy. Like, you got energy more than, you know, a lot of the kids. Like,
I don't know. The little school just, I don't know. I like it.
Yeah.
So, you know what I mean? The classrooms are fun. The Stuco's fun. I still do all the other, you know.
Yeah.
So.
I guess what was the worst year? What class was the worst year?
you know, it doesn't go by... We had a couple of years where the morale was low, but it was more the staff morale, you know, because of leadership problems and stuff.
And that feeds into everything.
Oh, yeah. You know, because principal and superintendent can make a difference, you know. So how that morale is on campus there. So that was many years ago. It was pretty, you know, people just kind of wanted to get out of here, you know.
Yeah.
But I had my own little world, and it was going good. And so
you always stay above it.
Well, I just try to keep, you know, what's important. You know, like, is that stuff really that important to me? No. Mm-hmm. You know, if it started affecting my classroom and Stuco, then I would have problems. Mm-hmm. But you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's never reached me to that level. So I don't know. I have seen a lot of good teachers come and go, though. I have to tell you, just... Oh my God, in all my years of all the people I run into, and you know, who was I talking to? I was having dinner with the Stuco advisor from Yuma High.
Okay.
And we started talking about people she knows that teach in Yuma. And I go, yep, he started at Antelope. Yep, she started at Antelope. Yep, she started. You know, how many people have we had here that went on to Kofa, Yuma, Cibola, Phoenix, you know, and, you know, for whatever reason, they just, you know, they left here and went on, you know, they wanted to coach a bigger school, you know, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it wasn't because they didn't like it here. It's just they wanted something different. It's
opportunity.
You know? Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and that is the bad thing about a small school. You're like right now, like I said, I'm teaching freshman English and junior English at a big school. I probably could just have one prep just doing just, I could just concentrate on freshmen.
Yeah.
You know, and here you might teach history and government, you know.
Yeah.
And you don't have any colleagues to talk to, you know, which is like when I'm like the government teacher at Antelope, he's the only government teacher. So
the only
time he gets to talk to other professional government teachers is if he's at a conference or something. Yeah. And that makes a difference because you pick
or
up
a Facebook group.
Yeah. Because that's how you pick up ideas and make your class more relevant and keep up with trends. And
that's true.
Because when I'm around English teachers, I'm always asking, what are you reading in class? What's your new novel? You know, what are you? I'm always looking for new books and novels and new approaches. So
you have to keep it fresh.
You do, because that's it's. Oh my God, that's one thing I love about teaching too. Every year is different.
Yeah,
you know, you don't. It never stagnates because you might have some classes that are, you know, filled with some assholes.
Yeah,
but the bell rings and
is that the benefit? It's just, is that a benefit you have from like what you teach? Because I guess I wonder if this is history. You can kind of keep it interesting because it's like. It's story. It's mm-hmm. that. But like maybe a math class, that would get pretty really routine, right?
Yep.
Because it's just numbers.
Oh no,
right?
I agree. That's why I mean, to me, English is one of the toughest because it's so much grading, but it's also one of the best because you can really get into their feelings, and into their imagination, and into what you know their journal writing and their essays. They can express themselves. Mm-hmm. You can just go so many different ways. And that's why I love English. Mm. But it does take a lot of work.
Yeah.
Where you're right. Yeah. And to be honest with you, not a lot of kids appreciate history. So that's always a challenge making it. You know, there's you have kids that like history, but most kids don't. You know, it's like, oh, that
unless it's ancient aliens, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You just have to tell them something. Like that's what Truett was so good about, all the oddities, you know, the odd things that happened in you know, have some little side stories, you know, about whoever you're talking about. But
I remember one time he was talking about some prince or something and he got sick and he couldn't swallow or something. Mm-hmm. He was like talking. And so he took a sip of his water, might've been vodka, I'm not sure. and he goes, and so he had this issue with his lip and just like let it all fall off. And he's like, you know, acting it out.
Yeah.
So he, you know, he took it to that next level.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, you just you got to be a little bit of a showman, you know, make it fun and funny.
You got to hold the attention.
Yep.
You're a performer.
Oh yeah, you do.
Yeah.
That's why if you went to my podium over there, I have a horn and a bell and all kinds of crap I could do right now.
Little like cat toys.
I have an air horn in there. Every once in a while my kids are real quiet and I'll go in and I'll just bring it out the door. I'll go, that was just for fun, guys.
Somebody walks out with shit down their leg.
I know, I know. Too
that's
fun,
man.
Anyway.
All right, Pete. Well, let's wrap it up. Let's get you on the road. Get you what you need. We'll do this again.
I hope so.
Real soon.
Anytime.
Well, whenever you can divulge more information.
Yes, yes.
And shout out to Jose Conchola for his CD. Hey, The Cup of Life, Let Me Blow Your Mind are a few.
I know.
Agent was Pete. You're his agent.
So sweet.
Oh,
I love
awesome.
It. I love it. I love it.
Peter.
I didn't have any really as interesting stories as Cardenas did through the blinds in the window. But
well, then
remember that. You know what I'm talking about?
Which one?
Cardenas, Gordo. He did. Remember his boss behind the window?
Oh, that's right. Ooh, yeah. That was wild. Remember he was telling me that when it was happening.
Oh
too?
My God!
I was like, what? Yeah, that was wild.
I know. I was listening to that one, Brad. I was just like, well, that's a crazy story.
Yeah,
crazy.
Yeah, he needs to do stand up.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah, I know.
And
he
you,
does.
Good luck on that too.
Thank you.
I'm anxious to see you. So fun.
Last bits of advice for
none.
None.
Oh, I don't know. For who?
Go
for
fuck yourselves.
just be true to yourself.
Yeah. If somebody wants to get involved in teaching, though, I mean, what would you tell them?
I would say tell them that it's extremely rewarding, but it's also very hard.
Yeah.
And this day and age where everything is, you know, it's based on test scores and they kind of, I don't know, what do you want to call it? There's so much looking at you from the top, you know, they're just always constantly, you know, watching you and evaluating you and the freedom to take a class in a different direction. If they're, you know, if they show interest in certain areas, you have freedom to go in a different direction. And the money is still, you know, it still sucks. It really is bad. I mean, it's not as bad as it. I mean, I guess you look at the salary and you say, okay, I only teach 185 days or whatever it is. It's not bad there. But in reality, I mean, they should be paid more.
Yeah.
But as far as rewarding, though, I would say, yeah, go for it. Because, I mean, I just think there's some natural teachers out there that just, you know, you can change kids' lives. So,
yeah.
I mean, I you know.
I got that.
I think you would love
it. We experienced that.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So. Definitely.
Yeah.
And so that's the rewards. I've always said teaching, you know, we're kind of like building our, you know, how people, you set a statue of me in the park, you know? Well, my statues are my kids.
Mm,
you know, I'm building the statues
beautiful.
As I go.
Yeah.
You know, and that's, I've always looked at it that way.
Yeah.
You know, you guys are all reflections of Antelope and the various teachers you've had. And
mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, no, that's a perfect way to put it.
Mm-hmm.
Pete, thank you for coming on.
Pete, just one of many Petes.
One of many Petes. thanks for coming
down. It's
been fun, dude. And I don't think you've given us an ought.
Ah. We still have that. We do the, in Stucco, you did all the cheers.
Yeah.
And I said, oh my God, my mind just went blank onto you.
Bing bang.
Yeah, the one about, they say astronaut style, you know, but then they have one now that says Pete style.
Yeah.
So I said, ah, baby. However they do it. When the kids do it at camp, I just laugh. I just, oh my God.
Yeah, and that's all you can do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know where that laugh even came from. Every once in a while, I'll just laugh, like unexpectedly laugh. My freshmen just all look at me and they just start. And I'm like, I've always laughed loud. I just always have.
Get used to it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sometimes I have, like at comedy clubs, I have to almost suppress my laugh, you know, because I'll watch game shows or TV shows and I'm like, oh my God, that person's annoying. And it's like, I'm like, that's how I sound. So I have to, I'm serious. I suppress my laughs.
That's a real life MFers meme.
Yeah.
MFers do this and like, I'm MFers. That's it. All right, fun. Man. Well, hit the road. I hope you have a safe trip and we'll do this again. Thanks for coming on, Pete.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
Take care.
Beautiful.
Ah, love you.
Ooh, love you too.